أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Before we start today's talk, let's just think about why we're here today. We're here to read the Quran. Why is that so important in our lives? If we think about it, we all dedicate a certain number of years for any career that we wish to pursue, whether doctor, accountant, lawyer. But if someone were to get up and say, my father was a doctor, so I'm a born doctor and I don't need to study medicine, we'd say he's crazy. We'd never go to him. If we think about it, there is one profession that we've all been born into. We all call ourselves born Muslims. Do we know what it takes to be a Muslim? Do we know what it means to be a Muslim? And how do we find out? We find out in this book, Al-Quran. What does the Quran mean? The Quran is literally derived from the root word qara'a, to read. So the Quran literally means the reading. Now, what is the Quran's message for us? Basically, the Quran is an invitation to all of mankind to worship Allah, to find out what it is Allah wants from us.
Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu
once described the Quran as being the ma'duba of Allah. Do you know what the ma'duba is? The ma'duba is where a king holds a feast and invites those worthy of his feast to it. So today we are all gathered here at Allah's invitation. Allah Malikul Muluk, the King of all kings. Now just imagine for a moment, how would you feel if you were invited to dine at the presidency? We might act cool about it, but inwardly we'd be delighted. We'd take out our best clothes, we'd put on our best society manners. We'd be so careful that we shouldn't commit any social faux pas. So when we are gathered here today, we need to know what manners it is that the King of all kings requires from us. The first etiquette when reading the Quran is, إِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا. When the Quran is read, then listen. Not just listening with your mind elsewhere, listen attentively. وَأَنصِتُوا, and be silent. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. In order that you may receive mercy, in order to gain from this treasure, we need to internalize what we're listening to. If you think about it, in this world, if someone we care about, someone who is important to us, is talking to us, we wouldn't be listening with our mind on other things. We'd be listening carefully. Think of the conversations you have with your best friend, or when your mother tells you, I've got something important to tell you. And we tell other people, keep quiet so I can concentrate. The second thing we need to remember is we need to believe in the Quran, that it's from Allah and that He has written each word personally for each of us. It's a gift of love from the Creator to His creation. Each ayat that we read, we should apply to ourselves. As Iqbal's father advised him, read the Quran as if it's being personally revealed to you. Not that we read it and think, oh, these hypocrites of long ago, or this is what so-and-so does, or I know someone who's just like this. We should apply it to ourselves. Thirdly, we need to reflect deeply on all we read. Not just listening once and then saying, oh, I know what's in the Quran, I've heard it. No, we need to reflect upon it. We need to contemplate it. And then we need to act upon it. Because knowledge without acting upon it is useless. For instance, you tell a child, if you go near the heater or you put your hand in the fire, it'll burn you. And he nods, and then he goes and puts his hand in the fire. You said, weren't you listening to what I told you? That knowledge for him was useless because he didn't act upon it. So if we're listening to the Quran, if we're deriving intellectual stimulation from it, but we're not acting upon it, it's useless. And in that case, the Quran will be an argument against us and not for us. Finally, and most importantly, we need to convey whatever we learn to other people. People say, oh, I know what's in the Quran. I've read the Quran. If they've read the Quran, why aren't they conveying it to other people? We need to convey it to all those who come within our sphere of influence, friends, families, neighbors, because the Quran, and this is the most beautiful aspect of the Quran, is like a treasure that multiplies the more and more you share it with others. The more you teach the Quran, the more your own understanding is enriched. And now we'll start the Quran itself. نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. ربنا زدنا علما. سورة الفاتحة. الفاتحة means the opening. Why is it called the opening? Firstly, because it's the opening of the Quran. And secondly, the doors of guidance are opening. As we enter this book, let's pause a minute and pray to Allah that Allah gives us the chance to implement the words we read in our lives. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladhina an'amta 'alayhim, ghayril maghdubi 'alayhim waladdallin. Amin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts al-Fatiha by saying Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most forgiving, the repeatedly merciful. This is Allah's first introduction of Himself to us. People have concepts of Allah. Some people say, Allah has been so unfair to me. Allah has been so cruel to me. What have I done to deserve all these problems? Allah starts by calling Himself Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, the most forgiving. Ar-Rahim, the repeatedly forgiving, the repeatedly tender-hearted. Alhamdulillah, all praises are for Allah. Why? Rabbil Alameen. Simply because He is the Rabb, not just of you or me, but of the entire universe and all that it contains. Whether animals, plants, human beings, whatever. See, Rabb is a really beautiful word. Rabb is not just the Creator. We all say, oh, Allah created us, and that's why we say Alhamdulillah. Rabb is a much deeper word than that. Rabb means the one who created, the one who nurtures, the one who sustains, the one who nourishes. Like a child loves his mother, not just because she's his biological mother, but because she takes care of him, because she's bringing him up, because she spends sleepless nights for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alhamdulillah. This is the most basic truth there is. All praises belong to Allah. Why? Rabbil Alameen. He alone is the creator. He alone is the nourisher, the sustainer. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Again Allah repeats, the most forgiving, superlative. His mercy encompasses all, whether we deserve it or we don't deserve it. Ar-Rahim, the repeatedly merciful. And this Ar-Rahim refers to the mercy of Allah, which will encompass the believer especially on the Day of Judgment. Maliki Yawmiddin, Master of the Day of Judgment. When you read this ayat, Maliki Yawmiddin, we feel a sense of peace and relief that it is Allah who will be deciding our fates on that day, no one else. If you think about it, is there anyone that we could ask, well, you would pass a judgment against me, and feel sure that they would pass a just judgment? Even if we were to ask our mother, can you give a judgment? And maybe even our mother would find faults in us. Yes, that time you did this to me, and you're not a good child. Maliki Yawmiddin, Allah alone is the master of the Day of Judgment because He alone has that complete knowledge of our hearts and of our true intentions, and He alone has that quality of mercy which, inshallah, will make Him forgive many of us. Some He will forgive without even mentioning their sins. Maliki Yawmiddin, this power is in Allah's hands alone. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. You alone do we worship, O Allah. You alone do we turn to for help. If Fatiha is the essence of a Muslim's belief, then this ayat is the essence of what our life should be. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. Allah, you alone do we worship. What is ibadah? We've restricted it to some rituals. We pray, we fast, and we think we've done our duty. Ibadah is much more than that. As we are taught to say in the Quran, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Say, indeed my prayers and my ways of worship and my life and my death all belong to Allah, Lord of the worlds. Every action we do should be for Allah. Deen and dunya are linked in the Islamic perspective. Thus we find from a hadith that even the morsel of food you put in your wife's mouth is a sadaqah. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. Everything we do should be done for Allah's sake and in accordance with Allah's commands. This isn't easy, is it? So Allah tells us, إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Ask me for help. أُدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Ask me, I will answer you. This will be difficult to live your life in accordance with my commands alone, but ask my help and I will give you that help. إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. You alone do we ask for help. See, the words that we utter, La ilaha illallah, so casually, without thinking about them, are the greatest form of spiritual liberation. Allah is teaching us to be free of people, to be free of fear of people. I don't need to ask anyone when I have my Allah that I can turn to for help. When I ask Allah, nobody knows about it but Allah and me. When I ask someone else, even if it's my mother, maybe a day will come that my mother will turn to me and say, now stop asking, I'm not going to give you any more. But the only relationship in the world where Allah says, ask and I will give to you. إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Now what is it that we ask Allah for? So many things. For wealth, for children, for blessings in our careers, blessings in our lives. Our du'as are restricted to worldly blessings. Allah teaches us to broaden our horizons. What is it that we should ask for most of all? اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ. Guide us to the straight path. Allah is teaching us that this du'a is the most important du'a of all. Because if someone has wealth, someone has degrees, someone has children, beautiful houses, but they don't have His guidance, then all that wealth is not going to benefit them on the Day of Judgment. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ. Guide us to the straight path. What path is that? There are so many cults, so many people who preach different creeds. صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. The path of those Allah with whom you are pleased. We don't want to please people, we want to please Allah. غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ. Not the path of those with whom you are angry. وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. No of those who go astray. As Allah teaches us in the Quran, قُلْ إِنَّ هُدَى اللَّهِ هُوَ الْهُدَى. Tell them that the guidance of Allah, that alone is the true guidance. Everyone thinks he's on the right path, but Allah alone can tell us what the right path really is. Ameen. Why do we read Ameen after concluding Fatiha? Because Jibreel alayhi salam said Ameen upon reaching the end of Fatiha. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when the Imam says, غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ, you must say Ameen. For if one's utterance of Ameen coincides with that of the angels, then his past sins will be forgiven. Surah Al-Baqarah. Al-Baqarah literally means the cow and it takes its name from an incident that occurs in this surah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alif Lam Mim. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنْزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنْزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ أُولَئِكَ عَلَى هُدًى مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Alif Lam Mim, حروف المقطعات. Now there have been different theories advanced as to what these letters actually represent. Some say that they stand for different names of Allah. But really, the beauty is that nobody but Allah knows their meaning. We don't know because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not tell us. Now right in the beginning of the Quran, Allah starts His book with a challenge to all mankind, with a reminder that, O man, you who might reach great heights in technology, you cannot discover anything unless Allah wills. Allah tells us elsewhere in the Quran, مَا أُوتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. You have been given but little of knowledge. So when Allah says, Alif Lam Mim, we read it, we believe in it, but none but Allah knows the true meaning. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ. This book, لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. No doubt about it. There is no doubt in it. There is no other book in the world of which we can make this claim. That this book is absolutely authentic. Or like sometimes when, you know, people write biographies and they say, containing the true facts just revealed. But you still don't know how much is truth, how much is lies. Allah says, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ, the only book, لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, no doubt about it. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. What does this book come for? Guidance. For whom? For the Allah conscious. Why is it guidance for the Allah conscious? Allah is reminding us, firstly, that He is answering our prayer in Fatiha, where we asked Him, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Allah answers that dua and says, هدى للمتقين. For those who read that Fatiha in every rakat of their prayer, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, Allah has provided the solution here. Here's the guidance that you sought. للمتقين. But only those who are Allah conscious will be able to truly benefit from it. Who are the Allah conscious? People say, oh, Allah knows how much I love Him and Allah knows how pure my heart is. Who are the muttaqeen by Allah's definition? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who believe in the unseen. What is al-ghayb? From a hadith we learn that it means belief in Allah, belief in the angels, belief in the divine books, belief in Allah's messengers, belief in the day of judgment and belief in destiny. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. Now iman pertains to our thoughts, our beliefs in our heart and mind. That's not enough. People who just sit back and think, oh, we're all Muslims, so Allah will enter us into Jannah. We need to prove that iman. How? يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. They establish salah. Salah, the worship of our limbs. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And from that which we have provided them, they spend. This ayat is a summary of a Muslim's life. Allah talks about the mu'min's beliefs. Allah talks about the mu'min's actions. When he fulfills the rights of Allah, the greatest right being salah. And then Allah mentions that this mu'min is not just sitting on the prayer mat all day and reading tasbih. He's involved in mankind as well. He cares about humanity. مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. They spend from that which we have given them. They don't give it all away, but they share the blessings which Allah has given them. What is rizq? Just the wealth that we have? No. It's all the blessings Allah has given us. Tangible, such as our wealth, our children, our houses, our clothes, our property, and intangible, our knowledge, our time, our talents, our energies. They share those with mankind. They are caring people. As the Prophet ﷺ said, أَبْدِينٌ نَصِيحَةٌ. Deen is well-wishing. It's not just selfishly being involved about yourself, caring about yourself. Allah goes on to say, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ. Those who believe in that which has been sent down to you and in that which was sent down before you. They believe in the Quran and they believe that the Torah and the Injil were revealed by Allah. And above all, وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. They believe with certainty in the day of judgment. Why is the word yuqinun used here? Only someone who has certain belief in the day of judgment will be able to do these actions. Someone who is really worried about the day of judgment, who knows that there will come that day when he will stand before Allah and answer for every minute of his life, only such a one can do all these actions. Not someone with a laid-back attitude. Now we need to know that these qualities that we've just read are farais. They're compulsory. If we flunked in one compulsory paper, what happens? Are we promoted? No, we're not promoted. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى مِّن رَبِّهِمْ. Such people are on guidance from their Lord. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. And such people, they are the winners. They are the ones who are successful. Now we can analyze ourselves and think, do we come in this category? Are we fulfilling all these actions? Because now Allah goes on to the second category of mankind. Indeed, those who disbelieve, it is the same to them, whether you warn them or do not warn them, they will not believe. Allah has set a seal on their hearts and on their hearing, and on their eyes there is a covering. Theirs will be a great torment. Who are the kafirin? The kafirin come under two categories. Kufr literally means to cover up. Now there are those people who greedily disbelieve, who say, I don't believe in Allah, or I don't believe in the Quran, or I don't believe in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then there are people who say we believe, who don't say that they don't believe, but their actions prove their disbelief. If you think about it, as we will read later on in this surah inshallah, when shaitan was told by Allah to bow down before Adam, he didn't say, I don't believe in Allah. He said, I'm not going to obey Allah. So when people willfully disobey Allah, that too is a category of kufr. Allah says, such people will not listen. They're stubbornly determined to go on doing whatever they feel like doing. And Allah warns us, theirs will be a great torment. Now that was the second category of mankind. Now we come to the third. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. And of mankind there are some who say, we believe in Allah in the last day. While in fact, they believe not. They think to deceive Allah and those who believe, while they only deceive themselves and they do not realize it. In their hearts is a disease and Allah has increased their disease. A painful torment is theirs because they used to tell lies. And when it is said to them, do not make mischief on the earth, they say, we are only peacemakers. Ala innahum humul mufsidun.
Know that these people are the true mischief makers, but they do not realize. Who are these people?
They are the hypocrites.
Now there are two kinds of hypocrites, and this is very important to understand. The first kind of hypocrites are those who pretend to believe in Allah, who pretend to believe in Islam, but their hearts do not contain one iota of Iman. It's a total lie from start to finish. Allah says, when it is said to them, believe as the people have believed, they say, shall we believe as the fools have believed? In other words, these hypocrites think that all those who follow Islam are total fools. They're totally naive, simpletons. Even today we hear people call others fanatics, because they despise them. Hypocrites pride themselves on being street smart, as the words are. They say, shall we believe as the fools have believed? Allah says, indeed they are the fools, but they do not know. And when they meet those who believe, they say, we believe. But when they are alone with their devils, they say, truly we are with you. Indeed we were but mocking. Allah mocks at them and gives them respite in their wrongdoing to wander blindly. These are they who have purchased error for guidance, so their bargain was profitless. And they were not guided. Their likeness is as the likeness of one who kindled a fire. Then when it lighted all around him, Allah took away their light and left them in darkness. فِي ظُلُمَاتِ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ. So they could not see. سُمٌ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. They are deaf, dumb and blind, so they return not. This example is an important example to understand. People who think that they are deceiving Allah completely, whose hearts do not contain an atom of faith, Allah says their hearts are sealed from understanding their truth. They listen to the Quran, but they can't absorb it. It doesn't make sense to them. It doesn't affect them. It doesn't move them. فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. They will not return. They are so far gone in that darkness of death, Allah will leave them straying in that path. Now we come to the second category of hypocrites. And this is really important for all of us. Or like a rainstorm from the sky, wherein is darkness, thunder and lightning. They thrust their fingers in their ears to keep out the stunning thunderclap for fear of death. But Allah ever encompasses the disbelievers. Who are the second kind of hypocrites? Those people who believe in Allah, but their faith is weak. So they believe in Allah and they obey Allah some of the time, and they disobey Allah some of the time. When it's convenient for them to obey Allah, when they're feeling spiritual, they'll obey Allah. But when they're feeling lazy or lethargic, or people around them are just not conducive to that atmosphere, they'll forget about obeying Allah. Allah says it's like a rainstorm. What is this rain? The rain of Islam. Wherein is thunder, darkness and lightning? What is this thunder, darkness and lightning? These are the trials, the opposition we face when we set out in the path of obeying Allah. Now think about it, when we set out to obey one command of Allah's, for those of you who might have taken up hijab, think of the initial response you met with, maybe from your family members, maybe from your friends, maybe from people you knew or cared about. What is it that you've done? Have you gone mad? All this Allah likens to thunder, darkness and lightning. All the trials, all the problems. Allah says, those hypocrites, people who are scared of people, will halt therein. They'll think, well, maybe we should do this later on. Maybe we should compromise because people won't let us live otherwise. Allah says, the lightning almost snatches away their sight. Allah is describing their fear of people, their fear of society. كُلَّمَا أَضَى أَلَهُمْ مَشَوْ فِيهِ. Whenever it flashes for them, they walk therein. وَإِذَا أَظْلَمَ عَلَيْهِمْ قَامُوا. And when it is dark upon them, they halt. Everyone's getting up to pray, so hey, I can get up to pray. But if no one's getting up to pray, I'm certainly not going to stand up and make a laughing stock of myself. Everyone's covering their head, so I'll cover my head. No one else has covered their head, so why should I stand out by covering my head? The hypocrite is one who wants the best of both worlds. He wants to please people most of the time, and he wants to please Allah some of the time. Allah says, such hypocrisy is not acceptable to me. If Allah willed, He could have taken away the hearing in their sight. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Allah is able to do all things. Allah doesn't need or want such half-hearted worship. Now we've read about three categories of mankind. Now we need to pause and analyze. Allah's talking about regular people like you and me. Which category do we come under? Do we come under the muttaqin? Or is it the kafirin? Or maybe it's the munafiqin? We want to obey Allah, but most of the time we're too scared or too lazy to obey Him. So we'll obey Him when it's convenient for us, and when it's not convenient, we forget about it. Now Allah comes to the central theme of the Quran. Ya Yuhannas, O mankind. Not O Asians or O Malaysians, O mankind, all of you.
اعبدوا ربكم الذي خلقكم والذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون.
Worship your Lord. Don't worship society. Don't worship people or your friends or what they'll say about you. Worship Allah. Like on CNN, they have this Egyptian girl's interview and they asked her, why do you wear hijab? And she said, I want to look pretty in the eyes of Allah. That's spiritual liberation. اعبدوا ربكم. Worship your Lord. Who created you and those before you? Why should we worship people? Why did He create us? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. In order that you may become Allah conscious. See, the whole purpose of ibadah, the whole purpose of obeying Allah is to develop that quality of sensitivity to Allah, that feeling of being aware that God is with us, Allah is watching us. Allah goes on to tell us more about what He's done for us. Who has made the earth a resting place for you and the sky as a canopy and sent down water from the sky and brought forth therewith fruits as a provision for you? فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا. Then do not set up rivals to Allah. وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. While you know. When everything we are getting is from Allah, why is it that we chase people? Why is it that we follow our own desires? And if you are in doubt concerning that which we have sent down to our slave, then produce a surah of the like thereof. And call your witnesses besides Allah if you are truthful. Allah says, if you think that this Quran can be bettered or this Quran can be surpassed, then produce a better Quran. Like people who say, oh, the Quran is backward, or the Quran should be revised, or certain portions should be deleted. Allah says, all right, if you're full of criticism, then make good your claim. Produce a better surah than this Quran. But if you do it not, and you can never do it, think about it. 1400 years ago, this book was revealed. No one has been able to surpass this Quran. Forget surpassing, they haven't even been able to come up with a surah equal to the Quran. Then fear the fire, whose fuel is men and stones prepared for the disbelievers. Allah says, since you cannot challenge the Quran, then either start obeying Allah or be prepared for the outcome which awaits the disbelievers and those who disobey Allah. وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And give good news to those who believe and do good deeds. In the Quran we find Iman and good deeds go together. Iman alone is not enough and good deeds alone are not enough. They both go together. That for them will be gardens under which rivers flow. Every time they will be provided with the fruit therefrom, they will say, this is what we were provided with before. And they will be given things in resemblance. And they shall have therein purified mates. And they will live therein forever. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَحِي أَن يَضْرِبَ مَثَلًا مَا بَعُوضًا فَمَا فَوْقَهَا. Indeed, Allah is not ashamed to set forth a parable, even of a mosquito, or so much more when it is bigger than it. See, Allah describes the attitudes towards the Quran. We just started our journey through the Quran. Allah warns us that there will be some examples in this Quran which we might not understand instantly. Like people say, oh, I don't understand the point of this. Why has Allah said this over here? Allah warns us, as for those who believe, they know that it is the truth from their Lord. This is a warning. When you read the Quran, and if we can't understand something instantly, our instant response, it should not be a critical one. It should not be a mocking one. It should be one of acceptance and humility. By it He misleads many, and many He guides thereby. وَمَا يُضْوِلُّ بِهِ إِلَّا الْفَاسِقِينَ. And He misleads thereby only those who are disobedient to Allah. If you think about it, only those people who don't want to obey Allah would be trying to pick faults in the Quran. Well, you know, I'd like to obey Allah, but I don't understand that bit in the Quran, and until I don't, I'm not going to act upon it. Allah says it's just an excuse that they've seized because they are disobeying Allah.